In one direction or another.
So yeah, you can go to the back door.
It was just the look of the girl.
Good.
Let us begin.
Yeah, sorry for that.
And it's my pleasure to introduce Brian House from the College of William and Mary. Sounding the virtual letter book we all have next to our bed.
Oh, yeah, good.
Everybody here, I'm sure at least. So without further ado, the scenario towards a specialty adequate to sound.
Thank you. I'd like to begin by playing some music. And here we go. This bit here, Rollins played more or less with his eyes closed. You notice that. Of course, it is not unusual for musicians to do this unless they're reading music. I'd like to suggest that in closing his eyes, Rollins is not merely indicating his lack of need to see things while he performs. He could be gaining something. Accessing something deeper, freer, sort of creativity that may be less inhibited. Perhaps he closes his eyes in order to become more attuned to a space of sound, proper to the nature of his ideas. In this paper, I will argue that the two sensory modalities that are primarily involved in our awareness of extended space, vision and hearing, present different features of space that are irreducible to each other, yet blended in experience. I seek to disentangle the features of visual and sonic space, at least tentatively, in order to mobilize an awareness of the unique spatial properties given through our perception of sound. By recalibrating ourselves closer to the space of hearing, I believe we open ourselves to a more radical experience of music and even of thought itself. Indifference and repetition, Deleuze references what he calls the spatium, a medium in which all sorts of difference, virtual and actual, coexist in a manner that would be impossible in a Newtonian space. The spatium makes appearances under various names in Deleuze's corpus, as Louise Birchall points out. She argues that the spatium is essentially temporal, manifesting a virtual continuum that defies inside and out. I suggest that this virtual continuum may be approached not just in theory, but in experience by way of sound perception. I'm not saying exclusively by sound perception, but here's one way, potentially. Here I'll propose a concept for what might constitute an intermediary to the spatium, a concept half-theoretical, half-radical encounter. through an analysis of the spatiality of sound, which will be distinguished from the space of vision, I will explore the beginnings of a concept I call the sonarium. Vladimir Yankelevich wrote that, quote, we need another Bergson, end quote, to do for the aural what Bergson did for the visual. On the face of it is a curious sentiment, given that Bergson did not present his theories of mind and perception as if they applied to vision alone. But as it has long been argued by philosophers and musicians, among them Yankelevich himself, not only is the so-called Western mind profoundly biased in the direction of vision, but language itself seems to lack terms and concepts appropriate to sound. And by the way, I'll say sound, I'll say music, depending on how they seem appropriate for the context, but I'm not going to problematize the issue of what's sound and what's music. Okay. All right. Let's try to sort this out a little bit. One of Bergson's famous maxims was that much error is avoided by thinking in terms of time rather than in terms of space. He didn't really mean that time should be stripped of spatiality, but that space, or rather conceptions of space, tend to be represented with fatal flaws, for example, with time cut out, or as consisting of identical units reducible to each other, aka the metric. Think of formal analyses that depict music as if it were a bridge, the end simultaneous with the beginning, or the airless two-dimensional pitch and pitch class spaces that falsely represent musical motion. Conversely, with time added back in, the possibility of representation seems to be lost altogether, but just at that point where actual music begins to flow again, entry to the real comes at the price of representation. Bergson discovered many errors in thinking spatially, which may be explained perhaps by their pragmatic evolutionary value. He attributed a basic error of intellection to a mistaken but practical reification of visual space that would have suited the emergent human capacities for reflection and practical problem solving. The important point here is that we have endowed the spatiality of vision with, and by we I mean humans, with correlate abstract spaces that are used interchangeably. Abstract spaces being the modus primarius of intellectual representations of the extended world. As Merleau-Ponty put it, these abstract spaces belie, quote, a medium without a point of view, without body, and without spatial position, the medium of pure intellect, end quote. Even if we root out abstract spaces and the representational orders that they service, we still remain uncertain about what experienced space actually is. Perhaps if we proceed step by step from within different sensory modalities, we may construct different properties of space from the unique forms of each mode. And again, I'm most interested in hearing and vision for these purposes. So let's consider some distinctions we might draw between visual and aural space. We're always receiving sonic information about our spatial environment. Whatever our overall sense of space might be, that sense is probably much more constructed through aural information than we may be aware. Not only is sound profoundly spatial, but its qualities are of a different nature than vision. They are not redundant with vision, or perhaps it is better to say that any perceived redundancy is provided by the integration of experience into the primary duration that is living itself. With vision, we are always at one end, and what we view stands apart from us. It seems the very nature of vision is to be discontinuous. We see the world one-sided, like a satellite dish. and only when our eyes are open, I might add. Hearing, though, is continuous in both the sense that it is continuously open, you know, our ears are always open, as well as the sense that what we hear seems to extend from outside to inside without any imposition or break by the body. We hear sound all around, our auditory systems forming a centrifuge, opening up to and receiving, I'll be a little poetic here, the whole of the cosmos. Unlike vision, sound places us right in the middle of everything at all times. And here is a fundamental difference that winds up making its way into philosophical systems and worldviews. The visual tends to support Cartesian-like dualisms. I am here, the world is out there. Whereas the auditory invites more of a non-dualistic experience. All right. I recline in my dimly lit apartment. It is night. There's a sound of rain on the roof. Distant and not so distant street noises reach my ears. I'm listening to choral music. Benjamin Britten, actually. I notice various strands of sound, cars, music, rain, colorfully differentiating themselves from various directions around me. When I close my eyes, I become intensely aware of the sounds passing through my consciousness, as if my thoughts were intermingled with and distributed through them. I focus on these sounds. They seem to glow in the center of my mind, just as much as the sensation of their coming from various distances and directions. I realize that my environment is saturated with sound, incredibly diverse qualities of timbre, distance, direction, even rhythm. I experience these things as I experience myself. I cannot find a seam between outside and inside my body. I suspect that between natural echolocation and the orienting function of the vestibular tubes, our auditory systems are primarily responsible for keeping us in the world. The world is given, it masses around us, seeming to direct all sound right at us from everywhere. And by virtue of that very massing, the world is revealed to the self via a profound connectivity, not through opposition or contrariety. When we hear sound, we experience sensations of distance, where the distance is just this quality, rather than registering to us as a measure. Aural distance is felt as a qualitative, not a quantitative amount. We literally hear distance. Of course, with distance, there is also direction, because our ears are positioned on either side of our heads. Tiny differences in timing, what are called interaural time differences, produce qualities of direction that inhere the quality of distance. In fact, direction and distance are experienced as indivisible components of a single qualitative multiplicity, what we hear in the sound as the sound. They produce inherent and necessary qualities of sound, just as magnitude, frequency, and duration. Bergson described how images, a word again which seems to presuppose the visual, arrive unstructured and incoherent, but along the way to being sensed wind up as structured and coherent perception. Key is how our memories fill in these incoherent impressions with virtual images selected from the past being virtual itself. In other words, what we experience is to an enormous extent constructed and mixed with material from the past, our past. And this is most true with respect to the, what Bergson called the immediate data of consciousness, which is in any modality, first a question of duration. Or maybe it's second, a question of duration. So I'll leave that. Deleuze puts it this way, Bergson's, quote, memory makes the body something other than instantaneous and gives it a duration in time. This graphic is adapted from concepts developed by Bergson, from Bergson by Deleuze, and also by music theorist Christopher Hasty. It depicts an imaginary moment arrested in time. The vertical gash can be thought of as a body presently becoming. BC indicates the ongoing duration of some sound, where B is the onset, now past, and C is the present, now becoming. B, by being past, is sustained by a kind of motor process of memory, which holds the beginning, the past beginning, with the imminent present. That which is past, but past for a present becoming, cannot be said to exist in the same way that what is actual can. But it is not nothing either. By being present with the present past, as opposed to the past in general, is virtual. I'm not saying the past in general is not virtual. Since everything that is has duration, it is easy to see immediately how significant and active the virtual really is. It is not an inaccessible abstraction, as some Deleuze-Guattarians seem to think. B1, C1 is not a different virtuality, but rather the same virtual image under its double aspect as both past and as future potential, that is to be repeated, or potentially repeated. The same duration can feel both past and not yet, ready as potential. That sentence just stopped in the middle, okay. So, like Bergson, I am committed to a virtual that is foremost the vitality of transfer between what is not yet and what is no longer. Everything that happens in sound space will involve the virtual articulation of durations within an unbounded space, which itself is virtual. So let's consider the process of hearing spatially in a simple illustration here. You see, I have a pop. It's very, very short, exceedingly short pop. And let's say there's no resonance. Anyway, so the sound expands as kind of centripetal, I guess would be the opposite of centripetal. And 20 feet later, hits somebody's ear, you know, just whatever is left of that sound, and then the ear projects the distance of the sound. It unpacks it from what immediately hits. Well, it's very complicated what goes on, very interesting. So what hits your ear is actually long gone from the source it has traveled from. Perception does not chase the sound waves to their source, like running the wrong way of an escalator. How could it do that? So what we hear as a quality of distance has to be something projected into sound itself. In experience, what I call a virtual sound projection extends from the center of consciousness out towards the former sound source, although we seem to experience it in reverse. Now, pitch. As the dimension of sound of almost exclusive interest to music theory, so-called pitch presupposes a music without spatiality, despite the misnomers of pitch and pitch class space. The questions of resonance and room size, placement of instruments and so on, are as much a part of what we hear in an expressive and not excessive way. Music takes up space and makes up space, no matter what we are listening to. The direction, duration, and distance of sound, musical or not, is part of the experience. If we bracket out the spatializing action of music, we've already lost the materiality of the encounter, and fictions and errors pile up from here, including the idea that the so-called building blocks of music are these atomistic points we call pitches. For pitch, I prefer the term tone, a foregrounded column of intensity blending into, reacting against, and perpetually escaping the larger field of resonance. Pitches are discontinuous abstractions or essences, whereas tones belong to a total immersive sound space. The pitchness of a tone, its continuous differentiation of different degrees of intensity, form a non-metric vector of up and down that is different in nature from, but fully blended with, the sense of distance and direction which themselves form non-metric vectors. So we have two different types of up and down in music, right? There's me talking higher, me talking down here. There's high and low. And we experience these as indivisible qualities in the same sound experience. And so again, it's these vectors are things that wouldn't work in a Newtonian space. This is another way of thinking their virtuality. We cannot map these vectors on a striated plane, or really even localize them aurally in a sharp, focused way. What we perceive is better described in terms of zigzags, curves, diagonals, densities, with numerous non-metric vectors or dimensions emerging and receding, according to what Deleuze might call the law of repetition. So let me talk about the scenarium specifically. It helps to understand the auditory system as learning over hundreds of millions of years to construct a sound from the discontinuous micro-fluctuations of air arriving at the ear from every direction. If we could see a sound happen, we would see a spherically shaped eruption of waves in every direction, disappearing almost instantly, except for the resonance left behind and the duration given to memory. So a given environment has thousands of these sonic bursts sweeping through the air, crisscrossing, dense and tangled. Though through an impressive set of structures, our auditory systems convert the energy of exceedingly complex pressure changes in the air to electrochemical signals, constructing for us a continuous sound environment radiating in every direction. And this sound environment, this continuous environment, I call the scenario. And one thing I'd like to point out about neurology that I find interesting, I don't know about other systems, but with the auditory system, there's always all the nerves that are attached to the, you know, the stereocilia fibers in your ears, in the cochlea. There's always they're always firing at some low rate, you know. So there's this sense in which the spatiality of sound is always being kind of produced, even if there's no sound. The concept of the scenarium refers to the auditory system and the sense of place and environment that it makes possible. It's a psychoacoustic and a topographical concept rolled into one. It is also a metaphysical concept. For at either extremes, the self on the one hand, the center of the scenario, and the world all around on the other, our consciousness is, at least mine is, unable to find a limit. Everything sounds in all directions and disappears in all directions away from the body without any limit, just disappears. Just as they cross over and disappear into the depths of my body. In the scenarium, we are positioned then between metaphysical infinites, bottomless being and endless extension. I want to take a moment and think about the qualities and the space thought, thinking. I think most of us sense our thoughts as located in our heads, as opposed to in an elbow or under a chair. Let's do a couple of exercises together. Yeah. So what I'd like you to do, you're not going to have to perform anything or take off your clothes. I just want you to close your eyes. Close your eyes. Without moving your body, I want you to think to yourself the itinerary of your journey home after this conference, or wherever you're going after your conference. So mine would be take the train from Brussels, fly to New York, fly to Richmond, drive to Williamsburg. Okay. But you think that to yourself. Go ahead. Okay. Unless you're like going 4,000. So this thought that you had, did it occur in time, or was it instantaneous? It occurred in time. Okay. Did you hear the words, or did you just see them?
See.
You saw them.
I heard.
Yeah. Well, let me give you this. I challenge you to try and think a word without hearing it in your mind. I can't do it. I don't know, you can try.
What?
To think a word without hearing it in your head. All right. Okay. Now let's try something a little different. I want you to try singing in your mind a familiar melody. Let's say the tune "Aboubiage Maman," which is I'm sorry I brutalized that. "Twinkle Twinkle Little Star." Pick an instrument, flute, a violin, whatever, and sing. Play it in your mind. Let's just do that. Pick a key. Go ahead, right now. Here's what I experience. May it be similar to yours or not. Besides being extremely difficult not to move my body in rhythm with the melody, especially breathing, I find that this melody is being articulated in my mind in the same resonant space as that which I use to think words. And if this is generally true, and we have already tentatively established the sonorous constitution of inwardly thought words, then suddenly maybe thought in general seems to be a lot more sound-based than we might previously have been aware of. It's something to definitely think about. Right to our core, humans are musicians fundamentally. We make sound and we think in virtual sound. In this sense, language then becomes a kind of musicking, with its own deal. It plays its own complex keyboard with thousands of keys, producing infinite qualities and gradations of sensation. So the space of thought is a virtual medium. It isn't in the brain. Mind knows nothing of the brain that supposedly contains it, except, indirectly. By listening to, or if you're on acid, by listening to a melody in one's head, by listening to a melody in one's head while attuned to the spatiality of its medium, one can literally hear it closer to one ear than another, farther forward or farther back. It becomes even clearer when one plays two different melodies simultaneously in one's head. Try doing that, not now. You might kill yourself. But, you know, it's something you do while you meditate or something. Try to hear two different melodies, not counterpoint, completely different floating melodies. They're like, in my experience, like two dancing sono holograms. And add the recitation of some text, like, you know, a poem or something, to the mix. Three distinct sound processes filling out the virtual space of thought. Which I said would simply opens up onto the quasi-extended virtual sound space of the scenario. And then add the rest of the sounds that you're hearing, virtual sound projections entering and exiting from near and far. They dance with the same sound figures one is thinking. So the center of the scenarium would be sound consciousness itself, where most of our thoughts crossing in and out of mind. Okay, that's an incomplete sentence. If it is true that thought, at least thought that crystallizes in the form of words and sounds or music, is sonorous in nature, and indeed inhabits the same space as virtual sound projections from outside, we could argue that in being sonorous, in occupying the same virtual space as perceived sound, the space of thought, at least to an important degree, is congruent with, maybe even identical with, the scenario. Imagine then the space that includes multiple scenarios, like this room, but with non-human organisms as well. Take a walk in the woods at night. Listen to the creatures sounding the virtual. Bergson details an impressive empirical conception of the virtual immediately aligned with the vital interests of the Earth's creatures. The detail and precision of his method inspired Deleuze to call it one of the most rigorous methods in all philosophy. Bergson's insistence on the primacy of temporality yields a conception of the real that is calibrated rhythmically, that is, historically. In harmony with both the actual world in general and our bodies in particular, Bergson and later Deleuze dissect or diagram a virtual that is at the busy intersection of the becoming sense of the world, the becoming of the sense world. This virtual is an active living force shared by all living beings, to which Deleuze superadded a pure or abstract virtual plane that is accessible to transcendental thought. Ungrounded in the present, transcendental thought travels up and away beyond the ordinary abstract to a fully temporal view of process. In this view, all categories and creatures give up their stability for a diagrammatic topological region of assemblages. To conclude, the concept of the scenarium attempts to bridge the divide between Deleuze's concept of the spatium, which is accessed through a transcendental exercise, and the vital becoming of lived experience. By isolating the mode of hearing, we discover a rich spatiality in which sound and thought merges, and the distinction between inside and out vanishes. With sound restored to sense, different routes for questions of musical process and idea emerge, while traditional theoretic representations that treat sound as measurable and disembodied are rendered lifeless and inept. By sounding the virtual via the scenarium, we place ourselves in a unique relation to both transcendental and musical thought. With all this in mind, let's listen to Sonny Rollins again. Only this time, we'll join him in closing our eyes. And while we listen, let's contemplate the spatiality of our experience.
Thank you. I subscribe to everything you said, except that I think you misrepresented the visual perception.
Okay, go on.
People who believe that, you know, what you described as spatial applies as well to visual perception, which is even further, you could say, even a model doesn't even need images. It's not a what you described as a kind of snapshot conception of perception when you see images, but these people believe, and I'm talking about activists, that we don't perceive images, we perceive embodiments of higher orders like gradients and so on.
Yeah.
Like topological space that you're trying to describe.
So
how about that?
So you're saying, what was that?
A moose.
What was that? You?
A moose.
Is
that
we are
immersed in an ambient optic flow.
That makes a lot of sense. So would you say that it's of the same nature of the sound?
I would say.
It's exactly the same?
Exactly. Yes, because we're talking about,
why does it have to be the same, of the same nature? I mean, it could have its own properties.
We are immersed in of this world. We are picking these invariants, either in solars or factory or perception. It doesn't really make any difference.
Well, why would we need all five senses then?
It's not five, it's 25.
Whatever, however many there are, why don't we just need one?
Ticks, as we heard this morning, have only three ways of constructing their finger. For us, it's perhaps much more complex, but it doesn't, it's not a matter of how many senses it is, and it doesn't really matter which ones you're using, because it's about picking up these invariants of the world.
Invariants of the world?
Yes.
Can you explain what that is?
This is how all the invariants, the fact that you don't see images, you don't hear sounds, you actually attuned to the world, you perceive as you act. And your action and perception are completely intertwined.
Yes.
So you said it's impossible to think between the two. So it's not like you here and the world over there. You off it.
Yeah.
Swimming, you're just thinking, you're picking up invariants. It's a kind of dramatic kind of view, right? That you extract, there's the resolution of reality is infinite. That you're picking certain things that for a certain purpose, as it were. Like you can go on, you can kind of discriminate even further and further. There's no limit.
Yeah, I understand. Okay.
I want to mention a couple of things, probably somehow an aspect connects to what you were saying as well. My impression is that I understand and I follow also very strongly on the idea of trying to define a different kind of spatiality which is not based on some of our given pre-assumptions that come from the domain of the visual. But it seemed to me that probably a stronger proposal has to do with actually finding different modality of the spatial, different, actually not one, but different modalities in plural.
Sure.
And it seemed to me like, what I understand is like in many times the way you were thinking about things and the experience of sound were completely based on the model of the container that you were criticizing when you were talking about the Newtonian model. For example, just to get some examples, when you were describing this idea about the sound traveling from an object to a perceiver, and you were talking about the non-resonance, it seems to me that you were losing many aspects.
That was purely heuristic,
But it's giving already, it's not giving tools to think about these different modalities in plural, because it's giving a certain idea of something which appears from beyond out of this model of consciousness that you're already involving us as if we already know what consciousness is and is a separation between the subject and the object.
No, it's for me the point was to show what happens when you put the thing in time as process that you have to recognize that some things happen before other things. But it wasn't to try to reduce everything to some schematic. That's not what I was trying to do.
I understand, but what I want to imply is that there are other layers that play in this mm-hmm. thing that I'm trying to call modality, mm-hmm. like that has to do with your decoding process. Like, for example, the separation you did, you talked about the spatial aspect of sound and qualities of sound, as if you could separate timbre from the spatial.
No.
In your description that you made of the rain, the fact that we experience the rain as being there or here or having that quality is we decodify that through timbral aspects that we
have
knowledge. So
yes.
And if I try to jump over to the point that I'm trying to get, is that several of these things change to the mode that we relate to, and not to a kind of given other kind of speciality that immediately comes from sound. For example, what happens when you experience sound of sine waves, pure sine waves, the experience...
You can't do that.
What do you mean?
Well, even if it goes right in, before it, you know, starts to hit your pinna of your ear and everything, it's already starts breaking up and harmonizing.
Pure sine wave, but let's talk more specifically about driving sine waves from loudspeakers and exposing to that. What I'm trying to say is that immediately on that, there's a completely different spatiality arising from that than to hear to a kind of impulses, for example. And that I found interesting in the sense that actually bringing that there is no one spatiality of sound,
right,
but also connecting to what you were saying, spatialities have to do with modes that we actually can understand, this whole package of consciousness, of the way we decodify reality. So,
that's a great point. That's a great point. And I'll say that maybe it'll help to understand what's motivating this project. I'm not trying to develop a metaphysics of sound space so much as trying to... It's more of an intervention project for music theory that intervenes. You know, it starts at the level of pitch and goes from there. You know, pitch and up, and doesn't consider the resonant spatial qualities of sound that are always present there anyway. And if you insist on that, then that changes the nature of all the objects that you're trying. It basically says, well, you can't do this kind of representational scheme. It won't fit. So it's a way of trying to begin a project of thinking through, how can we talk about sound, problems in music, musicality, questions of why does this work or that work, or at least how can we talk about the workingness of this and the non-workingness of that. That's the direction I'm headed, more of a music theory place.
But then when we are thinking about pitch, you're implying a modal space, because when you talk about spatial, you are already implying a modal
space. It's not going to be a striated space. There's not going to be striations or measures or... There's nothing like that.
Okay, but in problematizing, we'll try to find out what is it that you're putting in that model. And it could be without being striated, but you could be putting other things, like when you said that it's up and down. You're already using an action which is embedded in the model. Mm-hmm. As a code.
Good.
This is often a different direction, but I just want to pick up on the relationship between imagined sound and actual sound, just from your exercises, which I really enjoyed. And I suppose it's two questions. The first is, I wonder if you're familiar with some of the repertoire that deals with these. I'm now on camera. with some of the repertoire that deals with some of these issues of this relationship between imagined sound. Yeah, I mean, so there's this whole body of work of imagined sound or imaginary music or silent music. There's just for example, it really starts, I suppose, with Musik zum Lesen by Dieter Schnabel, and there's a book by Tom Johnson called Imaginary Music. And quite a lot of Peter Oblinger's recent work deals with, in some ways, what it tries to do is reverse your exercise. And it tries to make the case that those two things are, in some ways, the same thing. That imagined sound and sound are always the same. That process only happens cognitively. That the construction of sound happens only through listening, for us as humans. So I just kind of wondered where... You've set those two things up initially as a kind of pathway into thinking about sound, and I wonder what might happen if you reversed them. In other words, using the imagined version to tell us more about how we hear rather than how we hear to tell us about how we imagine sound.
Right.
Excuse me, wait till I've...
Nicely done, Jonathan.
Thank you.
You added that up. Great camera work.
You may speak.
Well, I have to think about it. Definitely.
The repertoire is a really funny problem because some of them, those early examples in particular, work largely with notational models. In fact, Enar's music does this as well, sort of drawing on known models for, say, trained musicians, the Oblinger things are really interesting for me because they tend to be like photographs, but my favorite one is a glass that's sitting on the edge of a table and it's in the process of falling. And Peter thinks about that very much as being a piece that has sound.
Yeah.
And it has movement. And, you know, we know what that sound world is, and it's totally constructive. There is no real sound involved.
Sound, but maybe not actual.
That's his point, is that is in fact real sound.
I'll think about it.
Martin.
So I'm actually going to go back to the first person's comment and keep it more quotidian, just habitual, ordinary perception. It's not that the eye and the ear are the same, we don't need to conclude that, but that they cannot be distinguished at this level of generality, perhaps. And so just to give obvious examples, you know, it's interesting you use spatiolocution. In Baka, people who walk around in the Central African Republic cannot see because the forest is too dense, so they have to hear their way through in very precise ways. And so the idea that it is the eye that is perspective and the ear that is immersive is quite false in that environment. In fact, it's the eye that's immersive, rhizomic, like blurred, virtual, and the ear that can provide perspective in that environment. And then the idea that the sound that you gave us from the image is a little slower and all that, and it's almost like the physics of sound being slower than light was doing some surrogate argumentation here. I think it's also false when it comes to hermeneutic understandings of actual sounds. If we think about Morse code, which is much easier for the ear to organize into a semantics than the eye. The eye cannot read machine-readable text, but the ear can hear those patterns. In the same way that, you know, now with the Olympics, when they come flying down the mountain, you can't see who came first, but you can hear it. So each athlete has got a different sound. You can hear it, but you cannot see it. It's just a blur of like Deleuzean sort of rhizome or something. So sometimes you hear it quicker, and sometimes the idea that these can sort of be bifurcated along kind of ontological categories or something like that that's the wrong word. I threw in the wrong word there. But at this level of generality, feels somehow a little off.
I'm sorry, I've done that to you.
What was on was very interesting. I guess back to that distinction, as a music theoretical enterprise, I mean, that can be much more successful.
One of the things about I guess, we just, I mean, to speaking in generalities, one thing about sound, it's always disappearing, right? It's always gone as soon as it's there. Whereas, and someone talks about, you're looking at an object, you have this there's this afterglow where you're doubling the object in perception. The object's still there, right? I'm looking at this computer. I know I'm looking at light, but I still am perceiving or thinking of this object out here. But with sound, it goes as soon as there never was an object in that sense. There's a lot of, in terms of the retention of the duration that we're involved in. And I think that when the more and more they do MRI imaging of brains and so forth, we're going to find these differentiations in the brain. We already are, I think. They're not like going into the same pot exact. They're going into many, many different regions that do different things.
The chunking, when you say an object, you remember?
I do remember chunking.
The chunking immediately.
Yeah.
Because an artist wouldn't see it as an object. Another ball of light wouldn't necessarily see it as an object. It's an opportunity for action. For you, it's an object because you know what it is and you've seen it before. So I wouldn't jump so quickly to chunk things as objects or tables or this or that. You see opportunities for action. These are invariants. They cool down, they eventually chunk, they become something this and that. But they start from this undifferentiated, capable of differentiation kind of spatial that you are describing, only upon a highly self-reflective, at that level of structure, you can perceive it as an object, becomes an
approach.
But it's not, you're turning around, everything in your visual field melts and changes, and the structure is always kind of wiped out, as you described, it goes out of vision. And as you say, most of the time it's amoral. We don't even see things that we see.
I hear you.
So the one that's not abstract is not.
But I'm trying to keep it practical.
Sure.
Yeah.
Another question.
To which extent does the sonorium tend to lower the barrier or blur the barrier between the inside and the outside of the body?
Well, as I've been thinking it and performing my own experiments, I'm just not being able to find a barrier, a boundary. It just seems to go right through. There's no sense of I'm here and that's there. It's like that's there and here at the same time. And there's this whole field of sound in between.
So it unifies, let's say.
Unify might not be the right word. But
no, okay, let's say it attempts to describe that space that is altogether existent between where sound originates from, how it exists inside of the mind, and how it exists in all the other shapes and forms as you associate, relate, remember, etc.
For me, it's about think of it this way, the visual world, I know it's a gross distinction. The visual world, your thought is inside your brain. But in sound, because that's what it is in the visual world, if it's in my head, it's in this small space. It's a very small place to be your whole life. Whereas in sound, I think it's much more distributed spatially. There's no need for a brain or a skull. I don't experience a skull in sound.
Oh,
I didn't even answer.
I'm kind of curious if you've ever come across this one. It's like a performance listening piece. I believe it's called Listening in Complex States of Time.
David Dunn.
Yes, David Dunn. And it's written much like a musical composition. Instead of the notes being notes that you would play, it's directions for listen 20 feet in front of you, very intensely at eye level, and then all of a sudden shift it maybe directly to your left, and then, I just find it's a very practical way of getting in touch, or maybe crossing those illusory boundaries.
Now that reminds me of some passages in Nalsi's book about the mobility of the ear. It's interesting. I think I have to talk enough.
Fine. I just wonder whether, in a way, it's a question of representation at the other end. If you've already denied that you're giving a primacy to vision in terms of inner space, you said that's not what you're doing.
There
seemed to be a suggestion that you were suggesting that the inner space was primarily visual.
No, I'm not saying that.
In which case, the visual representation you're talking about is actually at the other end of this abstract space. It's more a question of how you represent it when you're then going to talk about it. Mm-hmm. And of course, the representations, the visual representations scale. I can draw a sort of beer map version of the Van Eyck altarpiece. Mm-hmm. And you wouldn't like it, but you'd get what it is. Mm-hmm. But if I drew you a beer map version of the whole of a Beethoven symphony, you wouldn't get it. So maybe it's a question of representation at the other end of the space.
Interesting. Good point.
More question there.
No, I'm really done. Okay.
I have my hand up I'm so sorry.
I'm so sorry.
And we wasn't trying to. Anyway, I just
want
to go back a little bit to this imaginary versus real, just for a moment to ask. If you're talking about a music theoretical investigation, the reason music theorists are obsessed with the score is because it's a means of communicating of shared experience, right? So if you're talking about...
It's a set of directions.
Well, I'm not justifying it in any sense, but what I'm trying to say...
No, you're the same as what...
Yeah.
I don't want to give it any more power than it needs.
No, I'm just going back to this idea, if the real and the actual are the same thing, and they occur inside our heads, then how could we share experience? So how can I say that moment when Sonny Bones played that one riff, how can I say that? Because I I wasn't able to make a specific, yeah, I can hear it in my head, right? But how do I convey to anyone this moment that I heard and not the whole duration of the experience? Is there a distinction, or should there be?
I'm not sure. I want to grasp what you're asking.
So if I was doing music theoretical analysis, I could say that's a B7 chord or something like that. But in your type of analysis, as I see it, you don't want to do that, right?
Well,
you
don't
want to rely on that.
I don't mind. I mean, I teach music theory. I don't mind people being able to put names on sounds that are repeated. It's when those things turn into systems and they start measuring things and then producing what it is out of that, that I'm listening that way with applying functions and, you know, thinking, oh, now the dominant's here, and now, well, I guess we'll just wait for the dominant to finish, and then the next thing, you know, I just stopped doing that. And that's what I tell my music theorists, my music students to do. Eventually, when they're done learning the shit that I'm pounding into their heads, that they have to unlearn it. But that doesn't really answer. But
no, I agree with you. That I'm struggling with this concept as a music theorist. How can I get away from that and still talk to people?
Yeah, I mean, and it has to do with this the idea of the spatium, where there's a virtual continuum that doesn't have inside and out. And to me, that's such a hard concept to grasp. And when you try to grasp it, flies out like a wet monkey.
With that image, thank you very much.